Another blistering day around the bay. June 8th, 2017, we're in a race against time here, most certainly. We've always known that we really need to push ourselves so that we can get into singularity practice before the sudden umbrella-like implosion happens. So we're continuing to do that. And maybe we are sore, like I'm sore in my back, upper back, lower back, because I was swinging the golf club too hard and too many times. Push-ups, working out, I'm real sore. My arms went numb last night. But it'll loosen up. So it's just the attitude of, you know, let's push, but really the singularity practice is what we need to push, okay? That's where it's at. That's where it's at. So that's all we're really doing here at this point, is the singularity practice. Because this is what will save us when we've flattened out all value, definition, concept, all of that, and we're able to just stay in this flatness, there's no way we can be imploded. There's no way our mind can feel it's being imploded, okay? So the world has set up a trap of a massive implosion to try and implode, give the set feeling of implosion to the mind, which is an attempt to empower the mind, convince the mind it has the power to fixate the mind by seeing all this supposed unfixation. They say there must be that which has the power to unfixate must have the power to fixate. It's that kind of logic. But the mind, our mind, which is already flat, we flattened it out. We flattened our valuing out. In every which way, 360 degrees, then we can't be in turmoil. I'm looking for that 360-degree ball. I don't see it. It's somewhere around here. I had this, before I fell asleep last night, I had this experience where I suddenly found myself on this ocean, and I was surfing this wave. But then suddenly I was going in one direction, and suddenly I found myself going in another direction, and then another direction. And it was like chaos in the ocean. But I was always surfing in some direction, but it kept switching. And the chop and everything was unbelievable turmoil in every direction. And yet I stayed on the board. I didn't fall. And I I realized this is the result of the wow practice. The singularity practice. Because I said, okay, this direction is wow. This direction is wow. This redirection is wow. This chop is wow. This, you know. So, never had an experience like that, a dream like that. It was just showing me that this is what's coming, this chaos, where waves are just, you're going in this direction, and suddenly a wave comes right straight at you, and you turn, and you're going out to sea, then sideways, and then this way, and then that way. Of course, in real life, that doesn't, in our experiencing, that doesn't happen. But in turmoil, it does happen like that. So I was just able to remain steady and calm on the surfboard and not go in the water. The only part I went in the water was when it seemed to calm down. So I should have said, you know, calm is, choppiness is wow. Calm is wow. Choppiness is wow. Calm is wow. So it's the calm that threw me off. So calm is also wow. So we do opposite practice. Singularity practice is to do, you know, calm is wow. Turmoil is wow. Chaos is wow. Stillness as well. Chaos as well. Stillness as well. So in retrospect, I'm seeing, I had a dream years ago of this, several years ago, this massive storm suddenly brewing. And I saw it and I said, uh-oh, I've got to get to safety as fast as possible. And I finally found this huge tree, like a eucalyptus tree. And I got at the base of it, thinking that it's the canopy or somehow would shelter me, but it didn't. The storm broke and it didn't shelter me. And meaning the ways of the past, the ways that we think will work, aren't sufficient. And then suddenly, out of nowhere, I don't know where it came from, somehow this table was placed over me with this flat, I remember the tabletop was just totally flat surface above me. And I just kept, I crouched under that and just stayed under that, and the storm could not get to me. It could not get to me. Well, that's flatten, you see. The practicing of flattening out all definition, value, concepts, structure, hopes, everything. Love is wow, fear is wow. You see, we do not allow ourselves to get into a definitional dichotomy about anything. About anything. Do not hold on to any value, even love, okay, even peace, any of that. Do not hold on to any definitional value of that at all. Flatten it along with everything else. And of course, what is real still remains real, you see. But we're flattening our definition, our value, our structure, all of that. Hope is wow. Hopelessness is wow. Hopelessness is wow. Hope is wow. Chaos is wow. Stillness is wow. Love is wow. Fear is wow. So we're no longer trying to gain understanding of something, because this is at the conceptual, definitional, valuing level, which is the ego. And the ego is able to throw all that into turmoil. It's not stable. And yet, we're not quite ready yet to relinquish all definitional, conceptual valuing entirely, you see. We're not ready for that. So the bridge to safety is this wow practice. First you flatten it all. First you flatten it all. If you've already hammered everything down, what is there to hammer down? If it's already flat, there's nothing to hammer down. Flatness as well, and non-flatness as well. So I've been practicing all morning doing this. So I'm really into this practicing, and that sort of semi-dream I had of being in an ocean with waves coming at me from every 360-degree different directions and being buffeted about, but still always on the board, always feeling stable in the midst of this absolute chaos in the ocean. Shows that this wow practice is being very successful. Singularity practice. And wow is this very valueless type of value. It's not saying it's good. It's not saying it's bad. It's not saying it's anything in particular at all. You know, so it lends itself to this practice extremely well. So I very much advise, even if you're a freelancer, creative freelancer, to use the wow, okay, to use it. And, you know, being my experience in this world is people will not do what you say, so they'll freelance anyway. But I'm not going there. I'm not going to freelancing because this wow, I've had a lot of experience with it now. And it's such a neutral, devalued value that it lends itself to success in this practice extremely well. So I would say now is not a time for experimentation of freelancing. So this is being given out for these times because it is so effective. There are times when we want to experiment with all sorts of different stuff. Well, right now is not those times. So, wow is wow, and freelancing is wow. So work this wow into in every which way into your mind, into the entire so-called structure, belief system of your mind, that's the practice, is working it into that, like kneading yeast into dough. Okay, kneading yeast into dough, something like that. So knead the dough. You keep sprinkling, you know, some ingredient, the wow ingredient, on this dough, and then you knead the dough. You knead the dough. If you ever made bread, you know how that goes. And so eventually, the it's all spread evenly throughout the bread, and you know, entirely. That's called practice, kneading the dough. Poverty is wow. Riches is wow. Prosperity is wow. Destitution is wow. Destitution is wow. Prosperity is wow. The idyllic is wow. Carnage is wow. Destruction is wow. Safety, or what would you say? Safety is wow. Danger is wow. Safety is wow. Devastation is wow. Beauty is wow. Devastation is wow. Flourishment is wow. Flourishment is wow. Devastation is wow. Devastation is wow. Flourishment is wow. Flourishing is wow. Devastation is wow. Flourishing is wow. Devastation is wow. Flourishing is wow. Devastation is wow. So we don't want anything to knock us off our surfboard. We're surfing this ocean. Surfing the apocalypse is what we're doing. Surfing the apocalypse is what we're doing. So I put that as a heading for one of my Facebook pages, Surfing the Apocalypse. That's what we're doing. The apocalypse comes at you from every direction. So it's not your normal surfing. Different kind of surfing. Stability is wow. Instability is wow. Instability is wow. Stability is wow. Stability is wow. Instability is wow. Instability is wow. Stability is wow. Stability is wow. Instability is wow. Instability is wow. Stability is wow. So we just did three sets there. So we might start working into some, this makes it a little more intense. Safety is wow. Vulnerability is wow. Vulnerability is wow. Safety is wow. Safety is wow. Vulnerability is wow. Vulnerability is wow. Safety is wow. Safety is wow. Vulnerability is wow. Vulnerability is wow. Safety is wow. So that's the first time I've tried this. So that those are like sets. Very intense. Very, very intense. So we've just increased the intensity of this practice, singularity practice. But don't always do it that intense. Just like I need to rest from swinging the club too intense, golf club too intensely. My back got sore, tightened up. Everything tightened up. Second day, it'll tighten up on you. And that's what happened. So I have to ease off of it. I'll just be nice and gentle and give it, be wristy and still do it, but just be wristy. Practice on it, work on something else. Okay, what happens when your back tightens up? How do you swing then? Okay, just get much more wristy and get the pop from your wrist like that. You can still play, but get the pop from your wrist. I think I already started to loosen up a little bit there. So I really pushed it to the max to see, you know, how I'd feel. Well, I tightened up and didn't feel so good, but not a disaster. But I was pushing it to the absolute limits of what my strength could do. So I was just swinging just incredibly powerfully, but I swung over and over and over so many times, 3 times a day. Too much, you know, too much. So we can overdo it, but we kind of want to find out. So these sets that we do, I can feel like, yeah, if you really keep working that, it's like swinging really hard. So you can do sets of one, or is maybe a little better to start out with. Trouble is wow. Carefreeness is wow. Troubled. We could say concern. Concern is wow. Carefree is wow. Carefree is wow. Concern is wow. That's one set. This definitely ratchets up the intensity. I can feel it. I mean, we didn't expect this. You see, we didn't expect this. So we were getting used to, our expectations were getting used to a certain kind of practicing, and suddenly we throw this set at it, our expectations. And our expectations are like, wow, what's that? Well, it's a different wave in the ocean, isn't it? We need to make sure we cover these different scenarios with the ocean going berserk. Poise is wow. Berserk is wow. Berserk is wow. Poise is wow. Stability is wow. Instability is wow. Instability is wow. Poise is wow. Now, in that semi-dream in the ocean, surfing this chaotic ocean, it wasn't my practicing at that point that helped me. It was the fact that I'd already practiced, and my expectations were such that they weren't being shocked, so I wasn't being thrown off balance. If you expect to go like in a certain direction, like, okay, I expect to go in a certain direction, and suddenly you're thrown in a different direction, you're like, whoa, I'm not used to this, what's going on? And you lose your balance. But if you have, see, this direction as well, and this direction as well, we could say direction is wow, and misdirection is wow. Misdirection is wow, and direction is wow. Aim is wow, and aimlessness is wow. Aimlessness is wow, and aim is wow. So indeed, this affects us even stronger. So it's, practice is just like building up your strength in some physical exercise. I use a swing at a golf club. I'm getting better and better and better at it. But I can still overdo it, right? Which I did. But overall, the trend is it's getting stronger and stronger and stronger, no doubt about it. But I got greedy. I said, look at this swing speed I have. I should have quit. I said, okay, I've got it, but don't overdo it. But I got greedy. I said, oh, it feels so great to finally have this great swing speed. And then I overdid it. So we don't want to overdo. Now we have these sets now, and we say, oh, wow, we can do these sets. That means I could be really powerful practicing. But don't let's not overdo the sets here. We'll do a few of them. Just do a few of them. We've already done a few of them. I can feel that's enough. It's really causing a reaction. beauty is, wow, hideous. The hideousness is, wow. Turmoil is, wow, peace is, wow. Turmoil is, wow, peace is, wow. So we're gonna cool down from the intensity of this just a little bit. This is how you practice. You swing it hard and then take a break, cool down, rehydrate, so to speak. That's the secret of it. Not overdoing it, but do a lot and push it. But don't quite, you know, don't do such that you just feel collapsed and not able to do it. Keep doing it. So I've done a lot of stretching this morning. Boy, I was tight. Both my arms last night were numb. My back, it was really, I could feel it really tightened up from just a tremendous amount of workout. But that's good. I mean, I really get into it. My calves are so tight from the trampoline work and from everything. But it's the weekend, so I get to relax here. But stretch. And that's work too. Stretch out. So again, in our practice, we can tighten up and think, "Oh, I just can't do it today." But realize how important it is. Even the threat of implosion is enough to cause us mental troubles now, severe mental troubles, right? I mean, it's set up for implosion. The threat of implosion is like hanging over our heads like the sword of Damocles. And it's like by a slender thread, you know, and we're not going to practice. Just the slightest thing could break that thread. It's like a spider thread. And you say, well, how strong is that spider thread? I don't know, but it seems so thin and weak. Oh my gosh. So even though the sword hasn't fallen on us yet, it's very, extremely foolish to just believe that that doesn't cause us a great deal of mental grief and turmoil. Everyone is actually pushing. Those who are materialists are pushing to try and like do stuff to their houses and yards and like fortress themselves. They're pushing for their fortress, really, their cave, you know, their luxury cave. They're getting the big screens, the surround sound, the bars. They're frantically stocking their bars with everything. This is what they're doing, literally. The good life, you know. Let's ride it out the turmoil by watching television, watching movies, and drinking and using drugs. No, I'm not exaggerating. That's exactly, I know so many are doing exactly that right now. Frantically. That means they know implosion's coming. Stock that wine cellar, get the liquor cabinet, everything stock. You got enough alcohol to last you several years. You know, this is what they're doing. Getting a hold of drugs as much as possible. Clothes as much as possible. Anything to make them, you know, feel good. All their feel good stuff. They're hunkering down in feel good situations. Special relationships. Music. You know, make sure they have all this good music ready and access to it. And backup in case the internet goes down. They're gonna have like turntables. A lot of people going into vinyl now. Why? They feel it's not vulnerable to, you know, EMP, electrical implosion. Well, it would still be, but they could run it off a generator, you know. Or they get batteries, and they have an MP3 player. Of course, that EMP would implode that too. But they're getting vinyl, feeling that's less susceptible. And the turntables, less susceptible. And they might be able to still listen to music, you see. They're doing that. So all these trends are kind of like this bunker mentality. Bomb shelter mentality, actually. Bunker mentality. How can we... And of course, I know someone who literally had a bomb shelter installed. And they've stocked that to live down there. To live underground. To isolate themselves from the implosion. So most definitely the psyche, the collective psyche of the world, is in this mode, bunker mentality mode. But I would say that I haven't done any of that kind of stuff, but I have done the wow practice. That's what I'm focusing on, because that's what the Holy Spirit says will work. The other stuff, I've examined all the other stuff. I said, it won't work. It won't work. No way. But that's what many will try in the world, one way or the other, right? Many are stocking up on weapons and ammunition. That's their safety. They feel, if we have that, my mind will be at peace. So it's been going for a long time. So the threat of implosion in this world has been building up for a long time. It's like a demo. It's like the world is, demolition experts have rigged it, like 9/11. 9/11 was a warning sign of implosion that's coming, the coming implosion. And so the building might be standing, everything seems perfectly fine, and then suddenly the hidden charges are set off. One after the other, pow, 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 pow. The entire building implodes, like World Trade Center, Trade Center number 7 was absolutely... was absolutely demoed. You know, for a super, super hardened steel, reinforced concrete structure like that, with, you know, all the most modern architectural structural strengths and precautions, for a sofa fire, you know, there's a fire on some sofas in the kitchen or something, on one of the floors, to have the entire building collapse in a matter of seconds, like a perfect controlled demolition, is totally impossible. If you've seen controlled demolitions, you know how the building goes down. And the building, World Trade Number 7, went down exactly as a controlled demolition. Exactly. Collapsing into its own footprint perfectly like that. If there's a fire, even if the fire does some damage, it would twist, the building would topple one direction or another, you know, if it was structurally weakened in some way, if that was even possible. It would fall over to the side. It wouldn't collapse perfectly straight into its own footprint like that. If one side of the buildings gets real hot and the steel happens to melt somehow, and concrete happens to melt and all that, you know, if that were even possible, then that one side would collapse and the building would go over on the side. That didn't happen, did it? It collapsed perfectly straight into its own footprint. That means all structural support suddenly collapsed exactly the same moment. Now, how could a fire really do that, you know? I mean, how could the physics of a fire actually accomplish that? A sofa fire, you know? That defies, you know, defies logic. Everything would have to heat at exactly the same rate, have the same penetration, the same this, the same that. The oxygen would have to be just right. I mean, how could you get enough oxygen, you know, to heat it all up like that? It just, you know, makes no plausible sense whatsoever. But a controlled demo makes absolute sense. And with it, what happened to other buildings too. So the world, it was a sign that the world is going to be rigged to sudden implosion. Now, see, we are going along like world before the World Trade Center situation. Like we're saying, well, it's not possible. It's ridiculous. Nothing could happen like that. I mean, there's no way any of us, except for me in the dream I had, I was shown the scenario ahead of time. So I was pre-warned about it all. Over, you know, a year, at least a year in advance, I was shown the world, what happened, the airplanes being flown in to these buildings and crashing into them. I was not shown. It was so scary that you know, I just got the gist of it, what's going to happen. And then again, a month ahead of time, I was warned in a dream, in dreams. So I knew something, some tremendous implosion was going to happen. And I was spiritually trying to find a way to stabilize my mind. But back at that time, I was praying in various ways. Praying to, like, the Virgin Mary, praying to Jesus, the Virgin Mary, trying to find, you know, how can we find peace of mind? Well, that didn't work. That didn't work. So I've already been through being aware of implosions and trying different ways to stabilize the mind. So I know what doesn't work. What doesn't work. You can go to a shrine, Virgin Mary shrine, and sit there peacefully, but the overall mood is going to get to you in the world. It most certainly will. And that is not anywhere close to what is going to truly be able to actually work. It's this singularity practice that works. So I've already been through all this. So now I know, so we know that the World Trade Center, nobody, hardly anyone expected anything to happen. We couldn't have imagined this, right? How could that happen? Well, it was set up to happen. It was a setup. And so the world, we look at the world now, we say, how could this tremendous implosion happen on this planet? It's not possible. Sure, there could be some skirmishes somewhere, some trouble somewhere, except, but an overall implosion, that's just not even possible. We think that. Yep, it would be possible if it was all rigged to implode. It most certainly would be possible if it was rigged to implode. And we would say, well, nobody would do that. Well, someone did it with 9/11, didn't they? They most certainly did. And it may have been saying, hey, if you someone might say, if you don't treat us right, this is what's going to happen to you. You know, we're going to pull the plug on everything. And we've prepared for that, and we'll be able to get through it through cleverness, and we'll throw you into disaster. Somebody was flexing their muscles there. There was also a warning, sign of Jonah, sign of the whale, those huge black buildings suddenly collapsing like that, symbolizing the whale, symbolized by the whale. So we could have a sudden implosion, like an umbrella opening up. Absolutely. And I said that the people that come into this world have a great love of implosion. They believe that's salvation. So when someone believes that salvation, what they're going to do is one way we could have massive implosion is EMP. We've made ourselves vulnerable to an EMP. We're more vulnerable now than we've ever been in history, the planet, to a planetary implosion, by putting everything based on this very, very subtle electronics, high technology, unshielded, most of it unshielded. We've opened ourselves wide open to a global implosion through EMP devices, you know, electric magnetic pulse. We've made ourselves super vulnerable to electric magnetic pulse, either it's from the sun or from a nuclear, thermonuclear device. It's exploded high up in the atmosphere. So That's why I don't like electronics, high technology. I had this feeling like, you know what? I know what that's leading to. Whereas if you didn't have that, you could not implode the economic system, the banking system, the communication system, the distribution system, all the stuff. All our vehicles are now dependent on computers to an extraordinary extent. I mentioned once that this mechanic, he said, "I don't even open the hood anymore. It's useless." As a mechanic for 10 years, I could fix anything. He says, "Now I don't even open the hood. It's impossible." He says, "The cars are like are running themselves mostly with through computer chips." And so, EMP could disable almost all vehicles now, okay, in the world, render them useless. So, you're talking about absolute chaos could ensue with the EMP explosion, or a number of them. That's brought to you by our friends who have brought in high technology. So the far-sighted wisdom was totally against this being taken over by high technology, knowing that it was probably just a setup for massive implosion by those who love implosion, believing it's salvation because it proves the mind can fixate itself by going through this massive unfixation. We'll say, "Look, mind, look how much we unfixated like this. Look how powerful our unfixating is. That must mean you have a really great power to fixate too, right?" Those who believe that death is salvation by proving that there was prior fixation, since it doesn't really work, their belief is, well, we just haven't had enough death, and we haven't had enough death all at once. Okay, so they would work very tirelessly towards that goal. And of course, they would appear to be benefactors of humanity by setting us all up. So look how convenient all this electronics is for you. Look how everything's being run now automatically for you. But when it's all automated like that, it could all come crashing down in an instant, and we wouldn't have any idea of how to fix it at all, actually. So I've never trusted the motives of technology. I always felt the motives was death, absolutely. And we were warned about that too. Been warned about it. The motive is to unfixate, to show the power of unfixation in a massive way, to then convince the mind that it really does have this power also of fixation. How could it unfixate if it couldn't fixate? You see, right? It's a logical, it's a logic, the inexorable logic. If you can unfixate, if the mind is able to unfixate massively, that shows that it has previously fixated massively. You get that? And that's then what's trying to, the mind's trying to convince itself it's capable of fixation, so that it can fixate hallucination and believe in a new creation, that it's the new creator. And because it believed it hallucinated because the old creation imploded, it believes there's nothing to go back to. So if it's terrified that if it doesn't fixate, that it could drop hallucination and be completely imploded into an abyss of nothingness, total implosion. So it feels death is the way to prevent this by convincing itself that prior fixation must have been there in order for death to take place. So this is the whole structure of belief system of the mind, the egoic mind. Trying to loosen up the back. I was smart not to go out and hit balls today or yesterday. Very smart. I said, no. It's too hot yesterday. It's supposed to be almost as hot today, maybe another 100-degree day. Now, talk about lousy forecasts. I mean, I looked at the weather forecast about 3 days ago, 3 to 4 days ago, and it had really cool weather coming up. 70s. I said, "Wow, we're going into a cool pattern." And then gradually they said, "No, 80s." And then the day before yesterday it was like 89. They bumped it up to 89. Like, and that was it. Well, it hit 100 yesterday, and likely it hit 100 again. So they were way, 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 way erroneous in their forecasts. Who? Computers. Most of these stuff is done with computers now. So why are we supposed to trust computers telling us that everything's going to be fine in the world? No problem. Most of the newer generation comes from, they have great habitual expectations through previous lives where computer models are running everything. They get all their information through computer simulations. So they don't trust in their own spiritual intuition at all. They don't even know such a thing exists. They really don't. I once talked to this ET who was in this world, and they insisted they were a Zeta Reticulan. Their consciousness was certainly animating this body. And I asked them about saints and gurus and saints, and what are your perspective on this? I had many conversations with them online, and they said, we don't believe in saints, we don't need them. We see no necessity for that whatsoever. And what was their science? They say computer simulation. I mean, we have these supercomputers. They're able to run all these simulations of what's going to happen. So we know in advance what's going to happen. We don't need the Holy Spirit or anything like that to tell us what's going to happen. So that's how much they trust in computers. But they're also very insecure. They cannot take any joking around about themselves, about their self-importance. They have an extreme sense of self-importance. Why? It's compensation. Because deep down, they know that computer models are not trustworthy. But they're totally dependent on them. They feel totally dependent on computer simulations. And so they have to feel that, you know, our computers are super important. They're super trustworthy. Therefore, we are too. They're defending their computers. So if you poke fun at them, you're poking fun at their computers and their simulations, which they feel if they don't work, they're going to be thrown into an abyss, totally imploded. So they're very, very touchy. The reptilians, anyone who has a civilization that's based on computer simulation, they're extremely touchy, a vast sense of self-importance in compensation for their insecurity defending their computer simulations and their technology. If you criticize their technology, they become extremely angry, meaning extremely insecure. I say, I don't need technology at all to tell me what's coming. The Holy Spirit will tell me whatever I need to know. And I've seen the Holy Spirit's always right. Never makes a mistake. I may not listen correctly. Many times I don't. But when I do listen correctly, it's spot on. It is spot on. But we're so trained now to trust in computer simulations now. Most of the world are like lemmings. Which, for instance, everyone's going to be going to the beach today. And so far, the traffic has not been routed through our town that I can hear. Maybe it is. But it will be when the freeways get too clogged. The computers will tell us, go through this town, go through the surface streets, and then they all turn on this one street, also a side street off a more main street. They go through the side streets. They all turn and follow each other like lemmings. Why? They're all following the computer simulations of what's going on. But the thing is that when everybody turns on the same street, that street becomes gridlocked too. You see, but they're not thinking outside the box of the computer simulations. They become addicted to, especially, I don't use GPS. I make maps, I print maps, and I study the map, and I say, okay, I got the map. Because GPS, you become a lemming. And I almost got in an accident several times. The GPS says, turn right now. Make a right turn. You know, really demanding. Make a right turn. And finally I said, okay, making a right turn. Shut up. And I forgot to look to my left. See, there's a car coming. Because so I said, wow, that's it for GPS. It takes over your mind, a technology. And you simply just follow along, trusting it. And most of the younger generation, they just simply trust artificial intelligence to make their decisions for them. That's it. They think that's the best safety. That's the best safety we can have. Not true. The Holy Spirit's the best safety we can have. And if you understand the treachery behind technology, that you're being set up intentionally to not listen to the Holy Spirit so that you can be caught in implosion. They want maximum destruction and implosion now to try and convince the mind once and for all that, mind, you have the power of fixation, believe me, because you have the power of implosion, right? So then you must have the power then to, if you feel the power of implosion, that can only happen if you had the power of fixation in the first place. So we're trying to like remind the mind of its power of fixation, but as if the mind forgot. You know, we cannot admit to ourselves, it's difficult, that we never fixated anything. Because then if we're not honest, we'll feel, wait a minute, I'll be totally imploded because the old reality's imploded. And I'm going back to that, and I'll be imploded. So we can't allow that ourselves to believe that way unless we've repented and admitted that we just imagined the implosion, hallucinated the implosion of the old reality in order to imagine we needed to create a new one, you see. Unless we're honest, then we cannot allow ourselves to believe that we cannot fixate something. So we since we don't have this conviction that we can, what we tell ourselves is that we forgot. We fixated, but mind has somehow forgotten that it's done this. And so we say, okay, mind, we'll remind you. I say, gee, mind, you see all this stuff fixating, you still can't remember how you did it? Okay, we'll implode everything. And that'll be like shock treatment for you. And that you'll suddenly remember, oh yeah, I know how to fixate. That's our hope. You know, it's like a vain hope that we have. Death is really a vain hope to try to remind. We think that the mind just needs to have it be jostled in a shocking way to remember how to fixate, that somehow it's forgotten. It has amnesia, so to speak. We're trying to get ourselves out of this amnesia of forgetfulness of how to fixate. But we're not in any amnesia at all. The mind is fine. It's not a problem with the mind. It can't fixate. It has no power to fixate itself. What it is was created by God to be free. No fixation is possible. So there's no amnesia present. There's no reason to apply shock treatment to the mind. That's just futility. It doesn't do anything. There's nothing to remind the mind of. It can't fixate. So we need to remind the mind that it cannot fixate, not that it can. So death is totally designed to try to remind the mind that it can fixate. But if we repent and we're working on spiritual practice, we realize, oh, reality was never imploded. It's still absolutely flawlessly perfect like it always was. And so is the mind. We don't need death. We don't need destruction. We don't need chaos. We don't need any of that stuff. We don't need the shock treatment. It only gives its temporary boost of hope. And then things get even worse after that. The mind says, oh my gosh, I think I can remember. This is going to help me remember. But I still can't remember. It didn't work. Then what? You know? Oh my gosh. Right? Wandering in hellish realms, perhaps. Saying, maybe this will help me. I'll do penance in the hellish realms. We don't need the hellish realms either. But because of our expectations, we do need to practice. This theory is not enough of itself. It's comforting. It's clarifying and comforting. But because of our expectations are such that we keep getting pulled towards, well, I expect that I'm going to die. I expect that I'm going to need this shock treatment. So our habits can trip us up if we do not directly practice on those habits and really install new habits. So old habits are wow, new habits are wow. Old habits are wow, new habits are wow. Old habits are wow, new habits are wow. New habits are wow, old habits are wow. Old habits are wow, new habits are wow. New habits are wow, old habits are wow. Old habits are wow, new habits are wow. New habits are wow, old habits are wow. Simple, right? Very simple practice. Anyone can do it. Doesn't take any sophistication at all. Doesn't take any self-importance at all. You ask the ETs, well, why are you here? Why are you taking over the planet? Well, our old planet imploded. So you carry the habit of implosion. What imploded it? Well, it was something very unexpected. Our computers did not simulate it properly, a warn us properly, but we fixed that problem. Oh, really? Maybe you set yourself up through trusting in computers to implode your planet, so you wouldn't see it coming. Haven't thought of they hadn't thought of that. And so you're doing the same thing here. You're going to set up the same thing here. You're actually demo experts. And you set up implosion, you go from planet to planet to planet, the same story. Give us refuge, our dear planet. Our planet imploded. We had this terrible misfortune, and we tried everything possible, but the planet imploded. Please, love your neighbor as thyself. Come, accept us into your world. And we say, oh, okay, we feel so sorry for you. We'll give you, extend you charity, and come on into our planet. And then they just set up the same implosion situation that they did in the previous planet. And then when that happens, they go on to another planet, and they just keep doing that. They're demo experts, implosion experts. This love thy neighbor as thyself, not necessarily, right? I mean, some of these rules that we were given made it easy for us to suckers for these ETs, implosion experts, who brought this technology in, really making the whole world vulnerable to a coronal mass ejection, which is a massive EMP, so to speak, from the sun. Not all ETs are demo experts, because I was warned by some ETs that this is what they're setting up. They say, don't trust these ETs with the technology. They're setting you up for an implosion. The sun is expected to create some massive coronal mass ejection, massive EMP pulse to hit the planet. And if you're all wired up in a certain way, it could collapse civilization on your planet. It most certainly could. So I was warned about that way back, way back. So in the 90s, that was when I got these warnings. Now I don't know if it came from ETs or from the grace of God, from Dharma Kings. It seemed to be some ETs were seemingly, because the way their knowledge was such that it didn't have the grace of the Dharma Kings. And I was told that there so certainly are these ETs that are demo experts, and then there are others who are aware of this and say, don't trust them. Do not trust these demo experts. Some of the crop circles showed us that too. Don't trust these particular Zeta reticulants. They're setting you up for an implosion here. Some worry about comets, that comets can trigger these implosions from the sun. That's why also. They're also worried about solar eclipses. We have one coming up in August, I think. We have a couple solar eclipses coming up real soon, I think in the same year, especially over the United States, making a big X over the United. The pass of these complete solar eclipses makes a big X across the center of the United States, which is pretty interesting because an EMP device exploded right over the middle of the United States, like over up in the atmosphere over Omaha, Nebraska, could wipe out the electrical grid of the United States. And they're having this solar, and there's some that who believe that these solar eclipses generate massive amount of dark energy, so to speak, or negative energy for the lower realms by the dark magicians, so to speak, and they're able to use that then to trigger implosions here on this planet. So that's why often it's noticed that both comets and solar eclipses in history have preceded implosions, collapses of civilization, great wars, great troubles in this planet. There's a reason for that. There's a reason for that. It's been set up ahead of time such that when these events happen, implosions happen. And those who work that way, they're aware of these events that are coming up, the solar eclipses and stuff. They're able to chart that out with their computers in various ways. So they're aware of various triggers, oftentimes of EMP triggers from the solar sources or from other sources, perhaps supernova sources or something. So they set up the planet ahead of time to be imploded by that. Yeah, that's their business. They're experts at their business. And I believe a lot of religion on this planet was designed to not allow high technology on this planet. They tried to block it. That's why they tried to block science. They said science is evil. Science is wicked. It brings massive destruction. Well, that's because of experience in many other planets of this happening. So there was this huge effort here to use spiritual practice for salvation instead of death for salvation. Okay, and knowing that wiring the planet the way it's wired right now can bring about collapse of the entire civilization on the planet, actually. The whole distributions of everything, manufacture, distribution, everything. People just they starve to death. They get illnesses, they starve to death. And wars break out to get, you know, try to get what others have, stockpiled, etc. And it just brings this massive turmoil and chaos and collapse. It's been happened on many other planets. And so there was an attempt to block that on this planet. Unfortunately, it didn't work. But we do have enough dharma, enough grace here, to know how to practice so that we don't implode, that we don't see implosion, we don't experience implosion, we don't need to experience it. Now, Jesus says that the Dharma Kings, they literally don't see that at all. They don't see death, they don't see conflict, they don't see implosion. They don't see sickness. They don't see suffering. He says, from our perspective, it doesn't exist at all. We never see it. We only see perfection everywhere. Now, we're not there yet in terms of our perspective, our perception, our perspective. Our expectations have not yet been reshaped enough to go for that. So I always say that we could go to a reduced intensity zone. I was taken to a death-free planet realm, and shown that, as well as a reduced intensity zone, and we could go there where there isn't all this implosion. In the death-free planet realm, there's no trace of implosions ever happening. It's clear that they've never happened there. Everything that is growing there has been growing there from the very beginning. It's never been touched by any trouble whatsoever. So you're looking at a plant, that plant's been there for billions of years without any sickness. It's just in perfect condition. Everything's in perfect condition. So you can see, you can dwell there, you can dwell in a reduced intensity zone where the implosion might be really slow kind of thing, really very slow, very spotty, very little of it, that kind of thing. Much, much grace, great reduced intensity of it all. We can reshape our expectations for that. And we can also stay on this planet and help others rescue them by our own steadiness, you know, great steadiness. War as well, peace as well. War as well, peace as well. Starvation as well, feasting as well. Feasting as well, starvation as well. Starvation as well, feasting as well. Remember, all of this implosion is designed to panic the mind, and through this panicking, wake it out of amnesia so it can recognize how it fixated all this stuff in the first place. We're trying to recover that memory of how we fixated, and there's no memory to recover because the mind never did fixate. So we just go into panic, and it doesn't do any good at all except cause us extreme misery. So there's no reason to react to what's going on in the world, actually. No reason to react at all. And ultimately, there's nothing going on in the world from the standpoint of healed perception. Now, very few of us can understand how that's possible. Jesus said, you know, no death is happening at all. No wars are happening. No one's dying. It's not even taking place. Meaning, No unfixation is taking place because no fixation has ever taken place. So that's their perfect perspective. He said, like an ant, you see the ants being crushed. But really, nothing like, no ants are dying. Nothing like that's happening. And I trust in what he's saying, that we'll eventually be able to see that. Because there's no fixation in the first place, so how could unfixation be happening? It can't. It cannot be. We're misperceiving what's going on. We have a drastic misperception of what's going on. So to heal that misperception seems like a very drastic step. So we might be able to go to a place that there's just reduced intensity of this idea of implosion, which is why I've been trained in that, sent to like really beautiful places where you just feel like everything's perfect here. Nothing's ever gone wrong here. That was my last trip that I took in May. And I would like to schedule another one, please, to help out solidify that. I've done a lot of great work based on that. Been you know, relentlessly working, that where the house, everything was built so well. It was built in the 80s, at the height of before all the electronics came in, and it was built like the top scale, really top scale, where everything was built, everything had lasted, and it looked, and you look at everything and you say, it looks just as new now as what it did 30 years ago. It's just like astonishing. Everything worked. There's nothing going wrong with anything. The door still swung perfectly. Everything still closed perfectly. We can't build a new house that well now. It's just astonishing. So it was an experience of a reduced intensity zone where stuff just lasts. It just, you know... I caught on to that. I said, wait a minute. This house here, it seems like nothing has changed at all in 30 years. It seems flawless. I don't know. Who knows? They might even use lead paint back then. I don't know. But the paint, all the paint seemed perfect. This seemed perfect. Everything seemed like time and aging hadn't touched it, hardly touched it. So that was one of the main benefits of that trip I took. It's staying in this place where you got the feeling that nothing is untouchable, but by time really didn't touch it. Implosion really didn't touch it. Decay didn't touch it. The water, the plumbing was all worked fabulously. It was so great. I mean, and the plumbing fixtures, that's another thing. Plumbing fixtures these days, they don't last. Nothing lasts. I don't care. Look, our clients pay top dollar to have the best of everything. You go back 5 years later, and you got to fix it. They're constantly calling us. Oh, this didn't work. This doesn't work. This doesn't work anymore. And I talk to the suppliers. They say, well, it's all junk. They said, no matter what you buy, it's junk. There's always part of it is going to fail, for sure. Talk to an appliance guy, been working like 40 years or more. He says, you cannot buy anything now that isn't junk. You cannot. And so he says, I make all my money on service calls. I'm set for life. If you do service for like appliances and stuff, it's all about service calls now because everything's junk. Before, it was hard to make a living. If nothing breaks, how can you make a living as a service technician? And I've heard that. People say that most jobs in the future will be service-oriented jobs. You'll be servicing, fixing everything that keeps breaking. But for me, I can't fathom stuff breaking. It's unfathomable to me. So like when I don't even try to fix it. I say, no, it's something wrong. I'm misperceiving it, because there's no way that anything could break. Breakage is impossible for me. So I don't fix stuff. If something goes wrong, I just let it stay the way it is. I say it's not possible in my belief system. It's not possible that failed. Not even a light bulb. I say it's not possible that a light bulb fails. So I'm a really lousy fix it person. I simply don't do it. I don't believe that anything can go wrong. So I couldn't be a service technician. You know, that's just like, what? What are you talking about? I said, if something's wrong, no, it should be fine. It should be fine. And a lot of times people keep asking me to fix stuff, and I go to fix it, and it works perfectly. And they say, what'd you do to fix it? I said, nothing. It's just working now. It just works. I don't even know what I did, because I just have a disbelief in anything not working. I have such a strong disbelief in anything not working. From my standpoint, not working is impossible. And we call that the grace of the gurus. How do gurus fix things? Because from their standpoint, sickness is impossible. Trouble is impossible. So it's just not there at all. And then they convince you that it's not there either, and then it's not there. That's how Jesus healed. He says your faith made you whole, but Jesus entrained that faith. His presence was such that he didn't see any sickness at all. He saw perfect radiant health. And then that faith he had got into the one who was believing that they could be sick, and they suddenly stopped disbelieving that. Their expectations changed, and changed so strongly that they got well. Leprosy disappeared. They say, oh, that's right. I can't be sick. It's impossible. I can't change my perfection. That's how it actually works. Jesus didn't see their imperfection. Say, gee, let me fix your imperfection. He just didn't see it at all. It's impossible. You just have a misperception of yourself. For some people, you go somewhere and say, what if this breaks? What if this goes wrong? What if this goes wrong? What if this goes wrong? What if? In other words, they expect everything to go wrong, and lo and behold, it does. And for me, I never think of stuff like that. I said, nothing can go wrong. But, shockingly in this world, my expectations have been changed to some extent in this world, so sometimes stuff does go wrong. I'm not ready for it, but it does. So I try to say, I try to make sure I pray before I go anywhere, do anything, that nothing can go wrong. And I accept the grace of the Holy Spirit, the Guru, Jesus, Nandamaya Ma, Rama Harshi, Manjushri Papa Savan, Champion Kenzi Choki Lodro, the Guru being Lachempa, that I trust in your perception of my life. So I'm living according to your perception of my life, not my perception of it. I realize that I've been contaminated to some extent, my expectations. But I was aware enough of that to turn to the grace of God and say, let your will be done, we say, God, your grace be done, meaning your perception, your knowledge, your knowing of what is real. And then from their perception, nothing can go wrong. It's not possible. So yea, though I walk in the valley of death, I shall not fear. This is putting your trust in the your faith and trust in the perception of the Dharma Kings, the grace of God, and the Dharma Kings, and then nothing goes wrong. Interesting. When we were driving home, we almost got killed by this garlic truck. A truck hauling two trailers full of garlic. And they fell asleep. The driver fell asleep and suddenly veered over into our lane. But I was sort of so alert about something was going to happen. I'm in danger. I know. I felt it. That I was able to slam on the brakes fast enough so it didn't knock us off and cause us to turn over. Turnover could have caused a turnover, well, certainly. It was a very close call. And I said, okay, there's something about garlic. I really got to stay away from it. It's very important. Well, I just realized what it is what the garlic capital of the world is Gilroy, California. It's known as the garlic capital of the world. And the golf course, my home course that I used to always play, is in Gilroy. And I'm staying away from that course. Why? Because it brings about a feeling of trouble. That something bad's going to happen. Something bad's going to happen. Trouble, 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 trouble. And I begin to expect that my shot's going to go into trouble. And so it's conditioned me to fear, fear my golf game, so to speak. Fear that, so what do I do with this shot? No, that's going to be trouble. What do I do with this one? No, that's going to be trouble. And so it's a bad habit of mind that it was getting me into. So I was the last time I went to that course, well, actually, I walked off the course the last time I played it. After the seventh hole, I said, "I'm done. This is causing me to have really bad habits and expectations." And then we went back one more time for some lunch there or something. It was closed. Everything was closed. We couldn't get in. And that was just everything. It was all shut down. They had some issue where they shut it all down. First time I've ever seen that. So I was assigned, said, "Don't go back." And now I've been tempted recently to go back and play there. And suddenly I realize that garlic truck means don't do it. Don't do it. You'll go back into the old habits of doubting yourself and getting timid and hesitant. It will get into your psyche. What you want is a wide open golf course. I say, "Yeah, but where do I find that?" I'm still looking for it. And I went to this other course just a couple of days ago that also, if you lose, like, you can lose 20 golf balls there. It's so tight and treacherous. And it was closed. And the guys told me, "Oh yeah, we closed early today." I said, "What?" So that's another sign. Don't play there. Don't play there. Don't put yourself in situations that give you this notion that something can go wrong in your life. Okay. Now, we have to be warned that this is how we're being conditioned, because this world is set up by everyone wanting stuff to go drastically wrong in their life. So we certainly need to be warned about that. But our training should be, we should train that nothing can go wrong in our life. Put ourselves in a situation where we feel nothing can go wrong in our life. So that's why I was very important. I was long, Holy Spirit, Guru, Dharma Kings sent me, made sure I was sent to this place in the end of May. I didn't have any money, anything, but the money became available. A friend actually paid for it. And for the most part, we were able to scrap together a little bit here and there. And somehow we were able to do it. It was amazing. The grace of God did it for us, actually. And we helped out in a lot of ways, helped our friends out in a huge way. So it was sort of a, sort of being repaid for all our kindness and help that we'd done. And so we were able to go to a place where we felt like nothing can go wrong. That's the feeling I had. Nothing can go wrong. Except we almost couldn't get in because the computer system didn't have us in there. So we were hit with this one last, something terrible can go wrong. But it finally was straightened out. But when we're there, nothing could go wrong. So we're just sitting in this, spending time in the situation where we felt nothing can go wrong. And that's really important right now. This is what I've been stressing. So I'm praying for all of you who are doing this practice, for everyone, but particularly those who are doing the singularity practice. It's really important also to put yourself in a situation where you feel nothing can go wrong. Everything in the house where I'm living is flawless. Nothing can go wrong. I don't see any repairs anywhere. Nothing. Everything's going to last forever here. The furniture can last forever. I mean, the furniture there gave you the impression it's going to last forever. The carpet, the sliding, the windows, the sliding screen door. The I could tell the workmanship on everything, so different than these days. There was no flimsiness to the house at all. Nothing was flimsy. I said, this is going to last forever. The aluminum on this, there's not going to have to repair this house for another 100 years or more. Just this feeling that nothing can go wrong. The swimming pool, the way it was built, so solid and basic, nothing can go wrong. So I can just relax here. The palm trees, nothing can go wrong with these palm trees. They're not going to die of some disease or anything. Although woodpeckers apparently are a problem, can be a problem for palm trees. But these palm trees, you can see that they're just so healthy. Nothing could go wrong. They've been there for so long. So everything was gave this impression that this is the time. This is the land that time has passed by. So I was in this place where it felt like time had passed this place by. and couldn't touch it. Wonderful feeling. So this clued me in to this whole situation, and then from that point I was able to do this new way practice, having faith that, you know what, the Holy Spirit will arrange for us to dwell somewhere where nothing can go wrong. Because I didn't have the means, but the Holy Spirit found the way. Everything came together properly. It's really astonishing, because I had faith. The Holy Spirit promised it, and I had faith to say, I know you're going to do it for me. I don't know how, but you've never let me down, so you will do it for me. And it did. It did exactly on the date. It said, you will be May 22nd. You will be where I promised you to be. And I was. I was. Perfectly to the day. In a place that time simply had passed by. What couldn't affect it, could not affect it. Now, you could see vaguely that if enough time passed, it possibly could affect it, but there was no sign that time had affected anything. But you still could say, well, you know, maybe, you know, 100 years, 200 years, 300,000, I don't know, could be affected, but there was no evidence of it. But yet it didn't frighten you enough to say, well, everything's going to be perfect forever. You still could, so that's perfect. You know, it's like an intermediate state. Like, I don't see evidence, but at least time is still here. It's just not affecting anything. Okay, like that. No effect, wow, effect, wow. Time, present, wow. No time, present, wow. Nothing had seemed to age. You know, nothing had been touched by aging there. I was like, how is that possible? Wow. Quite astonishing in the modern age. You just don't get that. So because we're dialed into this, tuned into this, wisdom, we can have faith and trust in the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, the Dharma Kings, that we know what we need. And so they must know what we need. They've proven they know that. So this issue of reawakening the mind is what the world's frantically engaged in. And the world felt that I was so... They misconstrue non-dual teaching to mean that your mind somehow remembered how to fixate. And so they have a lot of faith in you. And then when you can't tell them how it's done, you say, oh, you must have forgotten. You almost have it, but you just forgotten. So if we put you in a really drastic, terrible situation, that'll shock you into remembering. And that's what's happened with me, my job. It is really an attempt to shock me into remembering how mind can fixate, because people believe I'm real close to understanding that. No, what I'm real close to is recognizing no fixation is possible. But the ego misconstrues this. So I've been put in a situation to try to shock me into remembrance. This is really tremendous insight here. Like I said, I have a job that's really lousy. I get put in very dangerous, stressful situations, very, you know, trashy situations, very dirty situations, very stuff that, you know, is like so terrible. You want to remember something better, and it's so this situation is designed to try to get me to remember how mind can fixate, because people believe I was so brilliant that I would be able to do this, and that I must have the answer, because I told everyone I had the answer. So, but they, for them, the answer means, how does the mind fixate? That's what they're looking for. So if you tell people you have the answer, they will then insist that you tell them how to fixate. So I say, you know, answer, wow. No answer, wow. All I have is the wow practice. That blocks panic. But I'm not saying I have anything other than that. I just have the wow practice. So that's why I was told to flatten out. Don't stand up and tell the world you have the answer, because that will be disaster for you. They will say, great, tell us how to fixate the mind then. And you'll say, and they say, oh my God, you just forgot. You had the answer? Yeah, I have the answer. But then you just forgot. So we need to immediately put you in a drastic death-based kind of situation. So you remember. We've got to shock you into remembrance. Wow. So you will indeed be, you know, put into some horrible situation designed to shock you into remembrance. Maybe some death-like situation that you're then the hospital, you know, saves you after, you know, severe trauma. And then they think, okay, you almost died, right? You almost got massive injuries, right? Okay, so that should have shocked you into remembering. You remember now how to fixate the mind, right? And you're like, you don't have it yet? Well, more sickness for you then. So never tell the world you have the answer. You have a practice where the answer is wow, having an answer is wow, not having an answer is wow. Having the answer is wow, not having the answer is wow. Not having the answer is wow, having the answer is wow. Having the answer is wow, not having the answer is wow. Not having the answer is wow, having the answer is wow. Having the answer is wow, not having the answer is wow. Now I'm starting to see it. That's why Longchampa says, get down, flatten yourself. In other words, just do this flattening practice. Don't proclaim to the world you have the answers. I'm not saying that this practice is the answer. I'm saying that this practice is wow. Okay? This practice is wow. Having an answer is wow. Not having an answer is wow. Because as we see this implosion coming, we have a great desire to help the world. So we want to stand up and say, hey world, I've got what works for you. You know, I can save you, you know, from all this trouble. But the world will interpret that in a totally mistaken way. They'll surely say, oh, that means you know how to fixate the mind, so tell us immediately. And if you don't tell them, and of course you can't tell them because the mind can't be fixated, then they will start applying severe shock treatment to you, thinking that it's right on the cusp, you almost have it, so you should be really treated in an extremely brutal manner to try and shock you into remembering. That's what I saw in the dream. This figure stood up and proclaimed that they had the answer, they knew, you know, and the snipers, you know, hit them with gunfire, and they collapsed. Now, I don't know if they died or not. They probably would have been, you know, rushed to the hospital, and maybe they would have been saved. And people say, okay, now you can be a savior, because surely now you've remembered. That's why they say the Antichrist will be gunned down in the streets. And then after 3 days, they'll reappear again as well. In other words, they'll, like, you know, be shot or something and be rushed to a hospital, and the reports are that they died, but then later on they say no, they actually came back to life and they were saved. And then people will then think that they have the answer, they must have the answer. and you came back to tell us the resurrection of Jesus. They killed him, died on the cross, and then the resurrection took place, and they think, okay, he's back. So he must now know the answer how to fixate the mind. That's why he came back. That's what they believe. This is why he came back. That as he went through the death process, he finally realized how to fixate the mind, this brutal death on the cross. So they thought that Jesus was such that doing all these miracles, he must know how to fixate the mind. So he's supposed to tell us, but he didn't tell us. So they got so mad. So, okay, he needs a real strong reminder. Crucifixion will help him remember how. And so then when he came back, they said, okay, Jesus, tell us. And he told them, well, I still don't know how to fixate the mind because it can't be fixated. I realized it's impossible to fixate the mind, so even crucifixion doesn't work. Nothing works. But that's not what we wanted to hear, so we're going to sort of twist and distort that into saying that you did find the answer, and that if we crucify ourselves too, you'll tell us. You're just not telling us. So now we have to really shock ourselves so bad so that we're willing to hear the answer. So that's how they twisted it. No, Jesus said there is no answer, because there is no way to fixate the mind. That's what he's certainly telling us now. But again, the distortion was the basic fundamental distortion is what, oh, we know you have the answer for sure, but you're not telling us why we're not worthy yet. So how do we establish our worthiness with you so you'll tell us the answer? And so for 2,000 years, some have been trying to establish that worthiness. We go to church and we accept your death. We know you really, you know, suffered a gruesome, horrible death, and that definitely caused you to have the answer, and we just need more faith that you did get the answer from that. And, you know, wow. Jesus is wow. No Jesus is wow. Answer is wow. No answer is wow. Jesus got the answer from the cross. Wow. Jesus didn't get the answer on the cross. Wow. Okay, Jesus got the answer on the cross. Wow. Jesus didn't get the answer on the cross. Wow. Ananda my Ma had the answer. Wow. Ananda my Ma didn't have the answer. Wow. Ramaharshi had the answer. Wow. Ramaharshi didn't have the answer. Wow. Or Ramaharshi has the answer. Wow. Ramaharshi doesn't have the answer. Wow. None of the gurus, Dharma Kings, have the answer. There is no answer to the question, how does the mind fixate itself? There's no answer at all. So they don't have any answer. Reality doesn't need any answer. It's perfect. What does perfection need an answer for? Where's the question? But we keep twisting it in our desperation to think that they must have the answer. And how do we get it from them? You know, what do we need to do? We need to worship them? We think, oh, we worship you, and you'll give us the answer then. It's just that you don't feel we're worthy. All right, we'll establish some kinship relationship with you. How do we establish a kinship relationship with you? Oh, we'll eat your body and flesh and drink your blood, and that establishes a kinship relationship, we believe. Because now Jesus' blood is in us, we have kinship, and then we believe he'll tell us the answer. Go to church, you see everyone, you get they're hoping like, this time it'll work, you know? Yeah. There's a desperate kind of look on their eyes like, you know, it hasn't quite worked for me yet, but it, you know, if I just have faith in it, enough faith in it, it will work, then Jesus will give me the answer. Well, faith in the impossible, how can that work? Through magic? It won't work. So, but we can say, work. It will work, wow. It will, won't work, wow. So we're not trying to push anything on anyone, absolute position. What we're doing is we're just saying practice. Certainly an absolute position is there. But we're not trying to gain that absolute position. Let's make that very clear so nobody feels pushed into panic here. We are saying absolute position, wow. Non-absolute position. Wow. Jesus saves. Wow. Jesus doesn't save. Wow. Jesus saves. Wow. Jesus doesn't save. Wow. Jesus has the answer. Wow. Jesus doesn't have the answer. Wow. Jesus has the answer for us. Wow. Jesus doesn't have the answer for us. Wow. Same reaction to both, you see? This way, you don't feel forced into some absolute position, right? Because we can't handle that yet. Our expectations cannot handle that. So either way it goes, our reaction is just wow. Flat, stable reaction to it. So we're not afraid to look carefully at the situation. We're not afraid. We're not afraid to that suddenly we're going to be, our expectations will drastically change. Because no, our expectations are answer, wow, no answer, wow. Whether there's an answer, wow, it's still wow. If there's no answer, wow. Whether Jesus' crucifixion saved, wow. Jesus' crucifixion didn't save, wow. The flesh and blood of eating the flesh and drinking the blood of Jesus saves, wow. Eating the flesh and drinking the blood of Jesus doesn't save, wow. Okay? Because our fear and our defenses against it have been so severe, we hallucinate the implosion of reality in order to believe we could create a new reality, when in fact it didn't implode at all. But the fear is so severe, and our expectations, our defenses, believing and fixating the mind is so strong, that when we hear that we can't fixate it, that the means we use, like crucifixion of Jesus, for instance, that didn't work, we cannot handle that directly. So what we have to do is say, well, whether if it worked, it's wow. If it didn't work, it's wow. Okay, this is the pragmatism of the Holy Spirit. But certainly, we have to practice both of those. Okay. We're not taking an absolute position. We're practicing taking just the wow position. Just the wow position. Which is nebulous whether this is absolute or not. Isn't it? Wow. The wow is absolute. Wow. The wow is not absolute. Wow. That's got to be a Facebook poster here. Texting. Of course. So-and-so, so-and-so shared. So-and-so, so-and-so's post. Oh, I really need to know that. I need to be texted that, you know. It's just like all important. Wow. So, fake Facebook text. Wow. No Facebook text. Wow. We have the answer, wow. We don't have the answer, wow. This is the kind of humility Jesus was talking about. This is the kind of meekness he was talking about. The lack of self-importance. Practice. I have the answer, wow. I don't have the answer, wow. Give equal value to both having the answer and not having the answer. This is truly flattening yourself. True humility, such that you are capable of dwelling in a place where you presume that time is there, but you don't see any effect of it. So, effective time present, wow. No effective time present, wow. So you expect wow, and you get it. You say, okay, everything is what I expected, wow. Certainly, if you see no evidence of time being present, you're going to feel wow. You're really going to feel elated and also some trepidation. Like, what's going on? But if we smooth it out, evidence of time present, wow. No evidence of time present, wow. Paradise is essentially this realm where there's no evidence of time present, really. No aging, evidence of time present. It's an intermediate step. So, going to paradise, wow. Not going to paradise, wow. Paradise exists, wow. Paradise doesn't exist, wow. Paradise doesn't exist, wow. Paradise does exist, wow. Paradise does exist, wow. Paradise does not exist, wow. Paradise does not exist, wow. Paradise does exist, wow. Paradise does exist, wow. Paradise does not exist, wow. Paradise does not exist, wow. Paradise does exist, wow. See, so no matter what happens, we're training ourselves not to expect an answer. The answer is wow. And no answer is wow. So we say, do I have an answer? Sure, it's wow. What's wow? Wow is wow. How is wow an answer? Wow is wow. That's how it's an answer. But you see, it's so abstract that there's not a feeling of fixation to it, right? It's so abstract. So we can have wow to solve all questions, to relate to anything in any way. The answer is present, wow. The answer is not present, wow. The answer is present, wow. The answer is not present, wow. The answer is not present, wow. The answer is present, wow. The answer is present, wow. The answer is not present, wow. The answer is not present, wow. The answer is present, wow. The answer is present, wow. The answer is not present, wow. The answer is not present, wow. The answer is present, wow. We go to paradise and we say, war is present, wow. War is not present, wow. War is not present, wow. War is present, wow. War is present, wow. War is not present, wow. War is not present, wow. War is present, wow. War is present, wow. War is not present, wow. War is not present, wow. War is present, wow. So when we find ourselves in some paradise realm, just remember to practice the wow practice. I'm in a paradise realm. Wow. I'm not in the paradise realm. Wow. I'm not in a paradise realm. Wow. I am in a paradise realm. Wow. I'm in a paradise realm. Wow. I'm not in a paradise realm. Wow. I'm not in a paradise realm. Wow. I am in a paradise realm. Wow. I am in a paradise realm. Wow. I'm not in a paradise realm. Wow. I'm not in a paradise realm, wow. I am in a paradise realm, wow. So that just, those last couple of practice really hit hard. Hit hard, I got hit hard, wow. I didn't get hit hard, wow. I didn't get hit hard, wow. I did get hit hard, wow. Not heating up too bad. But they said, but it'll get there. It's, what time is it? It's 11:11. Oh, again, I look at my watch and it's 1:11:11. Amazing. Oh, loosen up back. So even though don't feel great physically, we're able to do fabulous practice here, the best ever. I just feel, you know, it's okay. I feel lousy, wow, I feel great, wow. I feel great, wow, I feel lousy, wow. I feel lousy, wow, I feel great, wow. So what we want to do is block the panic of an absolute position. Okay, understanding first we wanted this intermediate step. We're not going to get the intermediate step unless we block the panic of an absolute position, because it's the absolute that terrifies us, because we're that gets into this issue of did reality implode or did it not implode. Right, that's recognizing that ultimately we can just look at it easily and without fear, clearly just see, oh okay, it didn't implode, and that's the end of it entirely. Ultimately we will get to that, but first we want to avoid an absolute position and yet still move towards it by getting off the absolute position that we must fixate the mind. Okay, so we're kind of saying, well, fixating the mind, wow, not fixating the mind, wow, fixating the mind, wow, not fixating the mind, wow. Faith tells us reality didn't implode. Okay, the Dharma Kings tell us reality didn't implode at all, but our expectations are such to directly try to abide in this absolute is too much trepidation for us. It seems too risky. So that's why we want to first devalue absolutes. Both fixation is possible and fixation is impossible. One value for both of those. One value for both of those possibilities. So we get used to just one value for the non-absolutes of fixation is possible, wow, fixation is not possible, wow, fixation is possible, wow, fixation is not possible, wow. Those are the two absolutes. We get used to one value for those two absolutes without choosing between those two absolutes. So you see how it's a bridge. Don't have to choose yet. I don't have to make a final decision yet. The bodhisattvas, they said, they don't make the final decision to, but what it really is they teach us how not to make the final decision so we can do this intermediate way first. But the bodhisattvas have made the final decision. Like Longchenpa, he absolutely has. But what it is he knows that not to pressure us into making a final decision, but first to help us make this intermediate step, take this intermediate step of singularity practice. So we don't feel pressure to make a final decision either way. And then when we get off of that, the facts will dawn upon us. We're just so obsessed. We've been so obsessed for so long that we have to fixate the mind, that that's become like an absolute for us, that's we have to get off of that. But if we think getting off of it means we have to get off on to the mind can never fixate, we'll be too afraid to do so. So what we're doing is we'll say mind can fixate, wow, mind cannot fixate, wow. One value for either of those two options without choosing the other one, you see? So that's the genius of the bodhisattvas. But certainly, the Dharma Kings are perfectly aware that fixation is impossible. It's never happened. So they certainly have taken the final step in that regard. They certainly dwell in the absolute. There's only the absolute. There's not even an absolute because it's just reality. There's no concept of an absolute at all. But they're advising us not to try to reach that directly. It's too difficult. So take this intermediate step first. So we've certainly gone over quite a bit in this video, haven't we? Massive amount. Best video ever. Now, we don't want to be kind of absorbed in lethargy here. I'm kind of feeling kind of tired from the effort, actually. I didn't sleep very much last night. It's the numbness in my arms. But we don't want to just kind of get into the lethargic mode here. So the Holy Spirit always makes it better for us. It advances us, our cause, right? Its cause, actually, and ours as well. So, what's next on the agenda? I'm thinking, where am I going to go next? I mean, what is it that is so peaceful as far as feeling untouched by time? Certainly, that's its trend. It has definitely, Holy Spirit has definitely over the years made certain that I trended in that direction. Made certain. The key is to get this feeling like, hey, time's absent here? It seems like time's absent here. You get that feeling, not an intellectual formula, but literally this feeling like dawns on you, like, hey, how come everywhere else is aging so much and this place hasn't aged? Literally experience that. Put yourself in a situation that where you literally feel that. So it's not an intellectual formulation. The only thing I didn't notice was a landline telephone. I wonder if they had one. Almost there. It'd have been nice to have a landline telephone there. Sure. The more we get towards an implosion event, the more flimsy everything becomes, so as to give us no recourse whatsoever. Whereas in phases where we're not headed toward implosion so rapidly, we tend to build things much more solidly. No planned obsolescence. We build things that last forever, try to. But right now, you talk to manufacturers, people know, they say everything is planned to fail now, and more rapidly than ever. The cell phone people told me, they saw my phone, says, wow, that's amazing, your phone's still working. I said, that phone was built to fail in after 4 years. And I say, was that all phones are built to fail? I said, absolutely. No, they want you to buy new ones. Technology's changing, all this stuff is changing. They want you to get more and more and more and more into more and more possibility of failure. They want you to get used to failure. They want you to accept failure. They want you, right? Yeah, accepting failure. Everything in our life keeps failing. We just start accepting implosion, like everything's meant to implode. I'm meant to implode. The world's meant to implode. Everything's meant to implode. You know, that's the way of reality, we think. That's a new reality. Of course, all doing this to psych ourselves up so we can remember how to fixate, believe that we can have hope that we can remember how to fixate. And of course, there's nothing to remember because we've never done it and we never can do it. So it's all much ado about nothing, as Shakespeare said, this whole realm, much ado about nothing, the entire wheel of transmigration, much ado about nothing. Doesn't matter how we psych ourselves up. We can never remember how to fixate because we've never done it, never will. Much ado about nothing. So this old woman that I met, she had this car that was so old, and it was like 27 years old. The car looked like it had just come off the showroom floor. She says, "Well, I keep it that way." She says, "I like that. I like stuff that lasts like that. There's no sign of aging with her car at all." Well, she was very committed to prayer. She was very person of great faith. See that? How that works? The more faith you have in reality, in the Holy Spirit, the more you're guided towards situations that where time seems to affect us less and less and less. So time hadn't even seemed to affect her car at all. But for me, a slightly different tact, I don't even bother to try and keep stuff up. Because for me, any time's impossible, you know, nothing can affect anything. So why go through the efforts to protect it? That just reinforces in your mind that time can get hold of it. So of course, if you get to paradise and your whole habits are to fix everything, you'll freak out because you'll say, well, I don't have anything to do. Well, I can't find what to fix. And you'll feel like there's something wrong with you. That you feel that you're misperceiving, because you say, I know there's something to fix here, I just can't see it. And then you'll try and destroy stuff so you can fix it, but you find you can't destroy stuff there. And so your mind will panic. But if you're in the habit of not fixing anything, everything's perfect, nothing needs to be fixed, wow. Nothing is perfect, everything needs to be fixed, wow. Practice like that to smooth it out. But when your habits have been changed, so you can practice in the wow, you won't panic. You won't panic. And then gradually you'll get used to paradise and you'll say, there's nothing needs fixing here. Everything's perfect. I don't feel like I need to fix anything. I just appreciate the beauty and the glory of everything here. So this video has really helped us in more ways than we can realize. It's been super helpful for me to recognize the underlying motivation for why am I stuck? Because I keep wanting to assert I have the answer. And so that subjects me to the ego's brutal treatment here. So instead, they'll say, no, I just have a practice. And the practice is not an answer. It's wow. The practice is just wow. That's all we can claim for it is that it's wow. So this could very likely cause a tremendously positive change in my circumstances, very likely. Now, if you win the lotto, what do? I would go to a place and just stay there where time seems not to have touched it at all. And then advise others to do the same. Maybe even help them do the same if they're practicing the wild practice. I wouldn't buy a bunch of new things. Buying new things is never the answer. Everything's made to break these days, flimsy. You're just setting yourself up for more implosion. What's really helpful is to see old stuff that's been around for a long time that still works great. Maybe that's why the Queen of Wow materialized that golf club for me. And it was like in fabulous condition. Looks like a brand new condition. But it's like 1980. 37 years old. It works great. It cuts into the turf. That's the style of golf back then, more than I'd like to. So I took it out of my bag. I want a more rounded sole with the way I swing. But the club worked great. It's there's no sign of aging to it at all. So what she's saying, go back to the 80s and hang out in the 80s, so to speak, in a situation where nothing seems to have been touched by time. That's very powerfully helpful for you. Not going out and buying a bunch of new stuff. So I tend to get used stuff. I really tend to get used stuff. The golf clubs I have now are used. At least the driver. The driver's an older model. It's not brand new. The 3-wood was used. The 2-hybrid was used. And so that's what's important. To have something that's not brand new that still works great is really important. The flatware we have, the cutlery, all this stuff, I've had it my whole life. It still works great. We just have like Corel white bowls, Corel this, and you know, it's been using it forever. Silverware, I've been using it forever. The cookingware, the pots and pans, my whole life, same pots and pans, 60 years. It still works just as good as ever. That's really spiritually helpful. And what's really not helpful is this constant cycle of buying new stuff, and having it break on you, buying new stuff, having it break on you. That produces really bad mental habits, which is really trying to force you into remembering how to fixate stuff. See? If everything you buy breaks, you feel desperate. I've got to learn how to fixate. I've got to learn how to fixate. But there's no memory. There's no ability to fixate. So everything is exactly as we want it in this instant, is the truth of reality. Nothing can ever be fixated. Therefore, nothing can ever be undone. We can never lose anything. If we want our attention to be held with a certain appearancing, we can have it held there forever. And Jesus says that the thoughts we think with God are forever thoughts. There's no boundaries or no limitations to anything. So really anything we think of is forever, actually. Our attention does not necessarily have to be on it, I believe, constantly. But everything that we imagine, we desire, is actually forever. Everything is the heart of everything, ceaselessly so. So we can never lose anything at all. Loss is impossible in reality. So if Ananda Maima can manifest something here in this world, maybe she can manifest an entire world somewhere that has this solid, well-built feel to it, just like stuff is not going to fall apart at all. No possibility of it. I mean, that club still had the original grip on it. There's like no wear on it. I said, holy cow. There's a few little signs of wear, but the solidity of it was there. So whatever wear was superficial. So you can have like a paradise realm, reduced intensity zone, that has superficial signs of wear. But underneath it, you could feel it's like very, very solid. Nothing's going to break. You might have a little bit of tarnishment here, a little bit of this, but you get the feeling, no, nothing's going to break. I just feel this. No way is anything going to break. So my nerves are really zinging, really zinging. I can feel it humming, like, wow. It means that that's tremendously successful here. We've really dug down quite deep here. So I don't want to overdo it. So I better, discretion is the best part of valor at this point. So I could go on and on and on, but let's calm things down a little bit. I'm going to allow things to calm down a little bit here so that we can get to it again, not far from now. Okay, so this video really covered a tremendous amount of ground, and we will say, we will let it resonate for a while. So the new way is wow. The new way is wow. The new way is wow.